part of what is frustrating to me is attempting to come back and tell the people exactly what you see and how you experience is very challenging to be able to do that. And to be able to see the need that's there is challenging to show in a picture. It's sometimes even difficult to show in a video, but it's allowing people to be able to realize that there's a whole nother world out there of people that have never, ever heard the gospel. People that live in the most challenging life situations that are just unimaginable for an American. My ability just to be able to somehow or another through this video to show people a glimpse of, first of all, the need, because it is just not the need for us to go over and do humanitarian work, but the need to just simply go and take them the hope of the gospel. People ask me, why do you continue to go back? Why do we want to go spend money over there when the needs are here? There are needs here, and we should never neglect that. But at the same time, the need for the gospel and the Great Commission is not just about our city. It's about our city plus Samaria, Judea, and the uttermost parts of the world. So to be able to show true Christians how great the need is, the fact that we live in a world where people have never heard the name of Jesus. That seems very incomprehensible to most Christians, but in fact, it's a very much a reality. And it's very sad that we don't open our eyes to see the need for the Great Commission to be fulfilled. And somebody said to me in the beginning, because I was just a little bit overwhelmed initially by all the responsibilities, and they said, well, how do you eat an elephant? I don't know. Well, one bite at a time. And I feel like that the Mamprusi people is our one bite. I have a heart for the world, but there's 200 and almost 90,000 Mamprusi people that are unevangelized. That's my one bite. I believe that's doable for Relevate Church and people that will partner with us. I believe we can really make an impact on that people group that's unevangelized. The sacrifice is huge, but we have a huge God, and He's our provider. It just takes those steps of faith that initiates God and His provision and the things necessary to be able to do what we do. When we begin this trip that we're about to see the video to, we had absolutely no money, none, not two pennies to rub together as it related to missions, but yet God supernaturally provided in so many different ways from so many different people. And the results was is that five people went and accomplished what God sent us there to do.
Well, the first thing I realized when I stepped off the plane in Ghana was the heat. It was an overwhelming humidity. And then it was just like a warm smell. It was like completely different than the United States. The air was just, it's kind of just like a smoky smell.
When we got there, the smells and the stuff that you saw was nothing like I was even thinking Africa would be.
The transportation in Ghana, we had something called Ghanaian air conditioning. And it was simply that. There was no ACs in all but one of our vehicles. And you had to roll the windows down, and it was humid and it was hot. But nonetheless, it was good. You know, not many of us complained at all, because they have to walk. And it's hot and it's humid and they're dripping, but we had airflow.
It was vans that were patched together to survive from day to day, because they just wire it together and make it work, and and the door would come open on us, so you had to keep it closed.
The transportation was unreliable at best. But it got you where you needed to go, whether you know you piled 4 people or 14 people into a 10-passenger van.
The traffic on the roads was interesting, to say the least. I'm a very skittish person when it comes to driving, so I just could not watch the roads.
And they will just go. I mean, you'll have a motorcycle just weave right on in there and move on and not even care.
No, we did not have to ride on top. Pastor would not let us ride on top of any of our vehicles.
I love the goats. They were everywhere. The night that we went out to minister at night to one of the villages, the goats are all sleeping on the roads because that's the coolest place. So they're all laid out, and they're just miles of it, and they'll be down there blowing their horn, and they're just slowly moving, just parting ways, or the guys who own them would come out and chew them. I pretty much only saw goats and sheep and cattle.
The biggest culture shock in Ghana just happens to be the kindness of the people. I would figure, you know, going over frankly, you know, being nothing like them at all, that they would treat you a little differently, but they treated you with the utmost respect, and they felt terrible if they offended you in any way.
They don't have the convenience of stuff like we do here. If they want a meal, they've got to catch it and cook it, and we can just go and grab something really quick and no, not a big deal.
The people themselves, the gratefulness, even though to us they would lack, or they would seem like they lack, they don't, you know, in their minds they don't lack.
But once you go to these villages, there's nothing. They don't have phones. They don't have power. They, you know, maybe one hut has power, and that might be the chief's hut.
Out there, those people would have some kind of made man hut or a breakaway where it's just a piece of metal and some wood, and that's just kind of their little area to sleep.
We weren't necessarily hungry or anything like that, but it was just, they live a simple life. It's a lot simpler than anything we would ever have over here.
Though these people had nothing in the eyes of Americans and Americanized people.
But because of that, they have a dependency upon God once they accept Him, once they understand the gospel.
When we actually got to the villages, they were not, they were, who was on the bus were the Christians.
I really can't say that we ran into any Christian people in the villages.
They had no idea who Christ or God was. They thought He was a fruit. They thought that it was just somebody who would give them something.
What I found amazing was that it was mentioned that this part of Tamale was not reached because they found them so uneducated, and it was almost like they were unworthy to be taught. And that broke my heart, because it almost made me think, well, when we go into these places, are they going to even accept what we have to tell them? But they were so open and so willing to learn. They want churches in their village so they can learn more about God. And so what broke my heart is, for all these years, why did pastors not go into these villages?
He's asking that can a Fulani tribe also receive Christ, because Fulani is a people group who they see as if they are not welcome. Okay, he's saying that can such a people group also give their life to Jesus.
Yeah, definitely. When you go over to these areas that are like small little villages, you pull up and there are mostly children that are afraid of your skin color. You know, there is some, of course, that are going to run up to you and they just grab onto you, they latch on, and they literally just want to touch you. But there's other ones that you like see one walking and you're like, hey, and you start walking up to them, and the next thing you know, I mean, you just, they're screaming, wah, and running out into the village, so.
He never seen a white skin before, so he's afraid of the white man's skin. This one is much afraid of the skin.
The rundown churches that are there in Ghana, I believe it's due to Christians not standing up, being who we're supposed to be. The seriousness, I guess you'd say. They don't follow through like we should, because if Jesus is that important to us. In Ghana, traveling, and what I observed the whole entire time I was there, I seen about four churches. That's including ours. But mosques were literally everywhere. The one village we went to, small village, I mean, it was the biggest building in the whole entire village. And I was just like, wow.
Jesus will pull it down. Jesus will pull it down.
We went to three villages in one day. The first two were during the day, and the third one was at night. So that one was pretty cool. The last village pastor was not feeling very well, so we all went with the pastors over there in Tamale. And we all had the privilege of going into the chief's house. The chief's house, you have to gain permission to enter their village. You have to gain permission to talk to their people. They are like the president over that village. You cannot pretty much go into the village without having their permission. So it was sort of like a ceremonial event to go into his house, gain permission, and then all the elders would be around, and they would have their little traditional thing, and then we could go out. Once he gave us permission, we could go out and talk to his people.
It was amazing to see how receptive the chiefs were and the people were. You know, we set up a little loudspeaker. And they just started coming in, bringing the sick, sitting around. It was amazing.
I would get a child in my arms and he would just hold on for dear life and just didn't want to, that broke my heart. they would want to just hang on and stay and not leave and go back to mom, and that was interesting. There was one little baby in the church, and I just wanted to bring him home with me. He couldn't have been more than a year and a half, 2 years old, and he was just precious. He'd see me, he was in two different services I was in, and he would see me and he'd come just straight to me. And this baby didn't know me. We did not speak the same language, but he just very loving.
I love children. I don't know. God put that in me. I believe if we can get to them before they made the mistakes that I made, they'll be better off. So when I got to Africa, and we landed in Ghana, when they smile at you, they just, they take your heart. You can't put it into words. There's no way I could ever put it into words. I just thank God he sent me.
When a person doesn't even really know what the Bible is, period. Not just, you know, don't know the Bible, don't know what a Bible is. You have to really think about it. So if they don't know what the Bible is, they don't know who Paul is. They don't know who Peter is. They don't know who John is. They don't know about the book of Revelations. They don't know about the book of Corinthians. They don't know about the book of Genesis. They absolutely have no concept of what we call theology or doctrine. And we just take it for granted because we've heard these Bible stories all of our life. We've heard about Jesus all of our life. You know, they have no concept of who he is. They think he's the guy that lives in the village, you know, across the way, or he belongs to this particular tribe. So they have no concept. We as Americans fall into our rut of how we do things here because of our culture, because of the people and our expectation that at least they know who Jesus is, at least they have some type of understanding of the Bible, at least Bible stories. So therefore, we're always in that doctrinal mode. We're always trying to teach people better, so to speak, when in fact that doesn't work there. You don't need a theological degree by no means. You just need to know what Christ did on the cross and through the resurrection. And you have to preach Christ crucified and resurrected and what that accomplished in the life of those willing to put their faith in him. And then expect God to show up, and he does. When they really hear the truth of the gospel, they become very dependent upon God. And their hunger for God, their faith in God, I believe is what activates the miracles that we see, the manifestations of God.
And we started walking this little village and walked through these like two tukus, and there was this lady just looked like a mass, body mass. It was just like a lump, like she couldn't move.
She had had the stroke. We were all around her praying.
And all of a sudden that woman just got up and started walking around. And her hut was one of the first in the village near where we had parked the bus. And before we left, we saw her over there doing chores.
To this village. It was late at night. We were supposed to get there the day before, but we couldn't make it. Some of us preached, like Christian preached and stuff. And then they asked everybody who needed prayer or was sick to come and start praying in the center. And at that time I was videoing, I wanted to get all on so everybody here could see. And after they're pretty much wrapping up, praying for everybody, I stepped back of the big circle of the crowd that was kind of surrounding. And I was just kind of stepping back, just taking it all in. And a older guy walked up with this little girl to me. Another Christian guy that was there with us said, oh, he wants prayer for his daughter. I called for Joseph because he was just a couple feet away from me. He came over and then, you know, he talked to him. And so we just started praying right there.
And we were laying hands on these people. And over here in the background, I hear Pastor Joseph praying over a young girl.
And Joseph laid his hand on her face and started praying. And I had the thought, you know, I believe it was God already in my head. And I was like, watch, this girl's going to be able to see. And then he calls over, I guess her dad. And he gets down and does something with his fingers. The next thing I know, man, it was like an explosion. I mean, Joseph grabbed her. They're dancing around. I mean, it was crazy. I was literally like, just starstruck. I was just like, is this happening? Is this happening? The new church that is built there in Tamale is it's pretty amazing. It is right off the road, which is not common for a Christian church. The Muslims like to try to push it back and hide it because there's such a huge influence, Muslim influence there. It, of course, goes into the government and steeps down. So they try to take over control of everything.
They were very excited to have, as they called him, their daddy, their papa, come and be a part of announcing it and launching the church that is now part of our church here in the United States. They were very humbled that they got sound equipment, that they got their music equipment, you know, that God blessed them with all that they had. And they were so thankful.
If you had seen their old church, it was no more than it looked like a tool shed. So it was a complete night and day difference between the two churches, and they were just excited.
It's built amazing. It is. I'm surprised that it's built as well as it is. And the other places where I've been, they just use dirt and kiln it or clay and kiln the bricks and build it, where all the blocks here are actually made with cement.
You tell them that this is the church. I'm blessing the church to you. The uproar and the zeal for what God is doing in Ghana blew me away.
When God provides everything for you and you don't lean on, say, doctors or ourselves and our jobs and stuff like that, but they know that all the provision comes from God. When they get in there and worship and praise, it starts out just with an excitement, with an extravagance, with a yearning that's amazing.
What they do makes us just look like we don't even praise God at all. It's just they go so far in their praise. It's celebratory. They celebrate in such a mighty and powerful way. Their praise is supernatural. It's not ordinary, and I don't think there should be anything ordinary about our walk with God, because we don't serve an ordinary God. There's nothing ordinary about him. He's supernatural.
I saw all the children, and they start covering their faces, and you feel the heaviness just come down. The presence of God is so heavy that it's just, you have to cover your face. That's like the angels.
They all would be praising, and their church goes for not hours, but hours and hours and hours. We would consist of 5 to 6 hours as a normal service for them.
If I strip away all the worries and wants that are so easily here in America, you know, chase the American dream, have nice, fancy everything or whatever.
And Jesus was all you had, and you relied on God for everything. How would you praise Him?
And not saying that nice things are wrong, it's just when our focus is on taking care of these things rather than our focus is on God. We all know there's nothing that we can do to repay Jesus for what He did. And we can't work our way into heaven. But myself, how high of a priority is He? You know? How much I can say, oh, I can say, I'm in full-time ministry, but how much am I thinking, praying for other people through the day? I don't even think I pray for my family enough.
I would definitely go back to Africa.
I would absolutely go back to Ghana under all circumstances.
Yeah, I would definitely go over again. I'll go wherever God sends me.
Oh, I'm going soon back to Africa.
I don't think anything's gonna hold me back.
Here in America, we want the fast and easy. We want the people that are easiest. That's why we have people who go from church to church. We in America lack bringing sinners and unsaved people to church because we don't want the effort.
He asked, were we serious about bringing a church into the village because the other people had come through and never fulfilled on their promise.
Just like people don't want to put forth the effort for the Mamprusi people because they are illiterate, they are unlearned, and they don't speak English.
My hopes is that this video is going to stir the hearts of people to the point that it will cause them to respond in some way, either to make that journey themselves and see if God has something further for them, or either to at least invest and become a part of it. If they don't have it financially, the investment of their prayers and intercession, whatever part that we all play together as a body of Christ to see Africa, at least Ghana, reached.
We have to do something. People are dying and going to hell because they don't know, and we know, and we have to do everything we can that's possible that God allows to go to them.